So good day. Today we will going to discuss another foundations of curriculum, the historical foundations. But before we go to our discussion, let us know first our class of objectives. So at the end of the discussion, we will be able to discuss how the different foundations of curriculum have shaped the current conceptions in the curriculum. And also, you will be able to gather information on how a school develops its curriculum to enrich the teaching practice. So in discussing this the historical foundations, we will tackle first the several curriculum theories and how they view curriculum from a historical perspective. Next, we also have the relevant aspects in discerning the historical foundations of curriculum. So we all know that history is an epitome of past failures and successes, right? Either academically related or not. So the history of education enables the people involved in the curriculum planning and designing what not to include in the curriculum. So its history helped the curriculum developer to include what is needed considering the needs of the society and the future demands of the country into the curriculum. So furthermore, the history of the curriculum plays a vital role in the development of the nation as a whole. So it tells the curriculum planners how to develop a good curriculum, what to teach, what materials to be used, what are the best practices they need to include in teaching, and many more. So the developments in the curriculum from the past greatly influence our educational system we have today. The Philippine education came about from various foreign influences, and most of them came from the influence of American educational system. So here are some of the prominent curriculum theorists and how they view curriculum from a historical perspective. We have Franklin Babbitt, Werrett Charters, William Kilpatrick, Harold Rugg, Collis Caswell, and lastly, we have Ralph Tyler. So let us now begin our discussion of these famous personalities in their with their contribution on curriculum. First, we have Babbitt. So Babbitt presented curriculum as a science that stresses on students' needs. So curriculum prepares students for adult life. So according to Babbitt, curriculum should focus on students' needs. For him, objectives with corresponding activities should be grouped and sequenced. So this can only be done if instructional activities and tasks are clarified. So for him, it can only be done if the objectives are specified, the activities and other tasks are sequenced. So for him, curriculum includes the experiences that the students could get that will allow them to develop their extended potentialities and assist them for their future endeavors. Next, we have Charters. Where is Charters? So, Charters curriculum is a science. It gives emphasis on students' needs, the listing of objectives, and matching this with corresponding activities ensures that the content or subject matter is related to objectives. So, the subject matter and the activities are planned by the teacher. So, similar with Babbitt, Charters' view about curriculum focuses on students' needs, the appropriateness of the activities with the objectives guarantees that the content is really related or relevant to the objective. So these activities and content should be planned by the teacher. Next, we have William Kilpatrick. Curricula are purposeful activities which are child-centered, meant for child development and growth. So for Kilpatrick, curricula entails activities that will cater the student's needs and interests. So curriculum should lead them for further development and growth. So the project method was introduced by Kilpatrick, where teacher and student plan the activities. He believed that the curriculum develops social relationships and small group instructions. So he introduced the project method. This comprises of the creative projects, the enjoyment projects, the problem projects, and lastly, the specific learning projects. So it involves activities that are planned by both teacher and student. So it comprises It comprises small group instructions, simulations, problem-solving activities, and the like. Next, we also have Harold Rugg. So for him, curriculum should develop the whole child, hence it should be child-centered. With the statement of objectives and related learning activities, curriculum should produce outcomes. Harold Rugg emphasized social studies and the teacher plans curriculum in advance. So for Rugg, curriculum should aim to develop the child as a whole. The statement of objectives with its activities should produce outcomes. In other words, the subjects to be taught inside the school prepares the students or exposing them to the world, then be able to apply what they have learned to real life situations. We also have Hollis Caswell. So he sees curriculum as organized around social functions of themes, organized knowledge, and learners' interest. So Caswell views curriculum as a field of study that is not limited not only to its content, but rather to the process that guide the students for more knowledge and experiences. He highlighted the importance of knowing the learner's interest as what have been presented here. Caswell believes that curriculum is a set of experiences. Subject matter is developed around social functions and learners' interest. Lastly, we have Ralph Thaler. Thaler believes that curriculum is a science and an extension of school's philosophy. It is based on students' needs and interests. He believes that curriculum should be based on students' needs and interests, just like the aforementioned curriculum theorists. Curriculum is always related to instruction. Subject matter is organized in terms of knowledge, skills, and values. The process emphasizes problem-solving. The curriculum aims to educate generalists and not specialists. So, according to Thaler, curriculum is the totality of all learning experiences. In other words, it comprises the knowledge, the skills, and the values executed by the school. So, it is not only focuses on the content or the fixed knowledge, but also the authentic experiences they could have while learning. So it covers both the skills and the values. The historical foundations of curriculum. So it enables us to know the historical development that shows us the different changes in the purposes, principles, and content of the curriculum. So the different changes are influenced by educational philosophy, psychology, and pedagogical theories. So this implies that curriculum is ever-changing, putting in knowledge and content from many fields of discipline. So these historical developments and education gives us an overview about the changes in the purposes, principles, and content of the curriculum. So these changes are guided by various pedagogical theories, psychology and educational philosophies. So with this, we can imply that curriculum involves varying knowledge and content coming from various or from different disciplines. So upon discussing that, let us now move on to the relevant aspects in discerning the historical foundations of the curriculum. So here are the five relevant aspects that will guide us in discerning the historical foundations of curriculum. We have the early Christian education, the Renaissance, the Reformation, the scientific movement in education, and the progressive education movement. Let us now first briefly discuss the early Christian education. So the values of early Christian education were a blend of Greek, Roman, and Hebrew ideals. The early Christian schools taught the liberal arts and also concerned themselves with inducting new believers into church membership. So since we are dealing with the early Christian education, its values were based on Greek, Roman, and Hebrew beliefs. So the schools doesn't only focus on teaching liberal arts, but also with instating new believers into church membership. So they encourage others to attend in the church and then serve. The curriculum of the early Christian schools comprised the teaching of discipline, church, doctrine, moral standards, Christian theology, science, mathematics, and astronomy. So it is the reason that their curriculum entails the teaching of discipline, the church doctrine, the moral standards, Christian theology, science, mathematics, and astronomy. They are not only focusing on teaching the liberal arts, but also concerned themselves in encouraging new believers into church membership. Next, we have the Renaissance. So the curriculum of the humanistic schools emphasized the study of mind as a prerequisite to understanding man's role and contribution to society. So during this period, humanistic schools were established. The curriculum stresses the study of man imperative to understanding their role and contribution to the society they part of. So humanistic schools curriculum include the teaching of good manners, morals, rhetoric composition, sports, games, and dance. So as the time passes by, the curriculum started to have vocational studies such as bookkeeping, business arithmetic, general correspondence, and the keeping of committee minutes and records because of international and national trade. So aside from that, people during this period recognized the need for a higher cadre of professional people. So Good stated that there are universities which develop faculties that offers studies in liberal arts, law, medicine, and theology. But during the Reformation, the humanistic curriculum was enriched with the study of science, mathematics, history, and gymnastics. Ignatius of Loyola, a Spanish priest, developed an advanced curriculum as a counter-movement to the Reformation in Jesuit schools. According to Caberly 1968, the Reformation greatly contributed to the educational growth through encouraging the church for more activities in all levels, such as in elementary, secondary, and higher education. After the Reformation, we have the scientific movement in education. So educators and philosophers of the 16th century were concerned more with observation regarding the working of the universes. This was led by Francis Bacon, among others. So it led to the philosophy of realism, which has three distinct phases with various implications of the curriculum. So during the 16th century, several educators and philosophers aimed to study the working of the universe. This was led by Francis Bacon. From this, it led others to the development of the philosophy of realism. So the philosophy of realism has three distinct phases that could have various implications in curriculum. So I will no longer read the definition, I will just give you a brief description of each phase. First, we have humanistic realism. So, a humanistic realist curriculum makes use of classical literature as a basis for improving the present world or cope up with the problems and needs of the world. So, they are more focused on making use or utilizing of classical literature as their basis for improving or for coping with the problems and needs of the present world. Next, we have the social realism. So, a social realist curriculum aims to meet the purposes of the contemporary world. So, the focus here is to teach the learners the knowledge of the world. However, it emphasized illicit education for the privilege for the higher society that involves schooling at home and with paid tutors. Lastly, we have the sense realism. So this was based on the belief that knowledge comes from the senses that enable the students to look or recognize the problems of the current world. So in other words, a sense realism curriculum gives importance or considered our senses as the gateways of knowledge. Lastly, we have the progressive movement in education. So the advocates of the progressive movement criticized the shortcomings of the traditional school system. They argued that first, the curriculum content of the traditional system included a great deal of meaningless and needless content. Next, they said that the traditional curriculum did not give utility education. It mainly emphasized academics. Next, the traditional methods of teaching introduce the child to subject matter of no practical value. Lastly, the traditional curriculum was rigid. So in other words, the traditional view of curriculum is the opposite of what a progressive education curriculum is. So the progressive education curriculum emphasized five approaches for better learning process. First, the teacher pupils planning of curricular activities. So the teacher and students planned activities together. The teacher here serves as a facilitator to help students locate, analyze, interpret, and evaluate information and be able to formulate their own conclusion. Next, progressive education has a flexible curriculum and individualized instruction. So it has a flexible curriculum and individualized instruction that teach the students how to cope up with changes happening in the world. Third, we have it is a non-formal curriculum activities and physical training in areas such as games and related hobbies. So in a progressive progressivist point of view in curriculum, non-formal activities and physical training that could cater the needs and interests of the students can be helpful. It could be through games and hobbies that will challenge their problem-solving skills and scientific inquiry. Fourth, we have the learner-centered methodology. So a progressive education curriculum uses a learner-centered approach because the main focus of the curriculum here is to cater or address the needs and interests of the learner. So the selection of material to be used should reflect the needs and interests of the students. Last, we have the selection of study material in line with the expressed interest and concerns of the learner. So the selection of material to be used should reflect the learner's concerns and interests. So this will help them to have a sense of direction. So all in all, to a progressivist, curriculum does not only focuses on the subjects to be taught, but rather on the needs and interests of the learners. It can only be called as a curriculum if the learners was able to reflect and apply what he or she have learned during the teaching and learning process. So that's end our discussion about the historical foundations of the curriculum. I hope you learned something from me. Thank you for listening. Bye!